I'm sick and tired of the blacks shooting up the blacks, and the police won't even do anything. They won't do nothing. If long as a black kill another black, they're not going to do anything. I'm a living example there because my son been killed. And it ain't been a year, and I'm still hurting.
My son was just killed.
And I'm hurt, and I'm hurting. Somebody put 3 bullets in my son's back. I'm hurting bad. I'm hurting real bad. Black people stick together and find out why all these people are dying for nothing. They shouldn't be dying. The black people don't care what happened to them. When the black people started caring what happened to them, they can put a stop to it. It's enough of we black people in the United States to put a stop to it.
I'll get it from him.
You want to get locked up for that thing?
They ain't mine. I would be goddamn in.
Right,
I would
hold on, man. It ain't sense. Make no sense.
Shut up and get to that.
In a community where people feel more occupied than served, more suppressed than protected, what role do black cops play? Are they public servants? Protectors of the streets and black life? Or are they informers? The Uncle Toms of an institution that has traditionally been at odds with the black community. Police officers enforce laws. Laws that some black people feel are not always in their best interests. But if someone's going to enforce them, is it better if they're black?
This officer here, cool it. You got to respect him.
No, he's telling me I'm going his old lady, man.
That's what he told.
All right.
You can demand respect.
I'll break your neck.
You can also win the respect of the people you serve.
I'm going to say
the dilemma of black police officers begins when they try to do just that.
I don't know him. Damn.
Win respect from the community.
I'll break his neck, man.
Damn neck.
On behalf of the law.
Not while he's here.
I'm going to break it after I leave, because then I have to come back.
Yeah, that's right, too. That's right, too.
You want to shoot me? Stop this. The third time this week, I've been busting. He'll tell you. For nothing. Am I lying? Is this the first time someone said I did something?
I get it.
And they shook me down? The third time this week, man, I ain't getting
them. Oh, yeah.
Hey, shake me down again. You want me to take off my clothes, man? No. No, I'm tired of this. Come on,
you want me to handcuff you, man?
I'm tired of this, Billy.
Stop it.
Why? 3 times in 1 week?
I know, so you must have a gun, man.
I don't care.
Somebody came up and said you had a gun.
Okay, let me tell you this right here. I got out of jail. I did 7 years in Walpole. I got out. I shot 9 people. The people set me up.
Put on your
coat. He'll tell you, in the sportsman, I got shook down 3 times in 1 night with the same boat.
Put your hands behind you. I don't know, man. I don't know what's going on. I don't know what's going on. Put that kid though.
Basically, before they were cops, they were probably good people. They got friends, but then you don't relate to anybody anymore when you're a cop. You just can't do it.
Hey, 22s?
Yeah.
Okay, nobody got shot.
Who sent them down there? Some pictures taken of them.
Yeah. Check with the NCIC, too, see if there's any warrants on them. Somebody might be looking for them.
Okay.
You know, as soon as they drive up, everyone looks around, you know, wondering what's happening. You know, who did something wrong? Who they looking for? That's the first thing people say when they see a black or a white car.
Did I resist you when you searched me?
You want the one?
one or so.
About 10:20, 10:15. Say, we got him at 10:20, so say 10:15. What's that, 518 and 47?
I am a 9 years boy. If I go back to jail, then I would be 9 years. That's why I asked you. I talked myself to be arrested because, Billy, the reason I asked you to arrest me, and you said I don't want to arrest you, the reason I asked you to arrest me, because I want to prove to you, because you show me you believe in me, right? Can I suppose, man? Mm-hmm. Now, I asked you to arrest me because I didn't want no trouble. I want to prove, like the officer said, the only thing you got to do is say that I asked you to arrest me, and I can go. But I asked you to arrest me because I didn't want no trouble.
They need to get together with the community, just the black ones, you know, and they need to talk about this.
Yeah, they can't do it with themselves. They can't talk about it.
They can't do it working with those white ones and using the methods that they use. They just have to get together and like, come out here to these games that are out here at night. You know, they'd only come if there was trouble. Come up here and watch the game and see what's happening. And take off those uniforms. I think that's what the whole thing, this uniform is a symbol. You know, and you see them in this blue uniform, and that's the first thing. You know, if you could be cops. We don't know, but we're open to you. You know, but if you came over here with the uniform on, no one's gonna say nothing. You know, that's what they need. They need to break it down from right there. Change those uniforms and get out and see some people and start doing some things. That's the only way I think it's gonna change anyway.
You want people to treat you decent, you have to also treat people decent. He asked you to wait, that he has a ticket for you to use.
Because
you
I got out of the car?
You could be arrested without a warrant for it.
Because I got out of the car?
I said you could be arrested for that.
Because now, I got out of the car, I'm going to take a ticket?
Look, there you were double parked there.
Double parked? I got out of the car. I wasn't parked nowhere.
Okay.
I don't want that.
Well, it's fairly good, but it always could be better. Last week we had an incident here where three young fellows come in, about 20, 21 years old. Two engaged us at the office. One ran downstairs. We didn't know he ran downstairs, and all of a sudden they tried to put rings on their fingers, so we put the rings away out of the in the showcase, and before you know it, one fellow hollered to the other fellow. He said, Wayne, where are you? We didn't know what he was talking about. Wayne jumped from downstairs, upstairs, and he had something in his hand, and out he went, and the other two fellows followed him, and they ran out, and actually we knew they snatched something, but what, we don't know, because we have stock downstairs. We have inventory of all description downstairs. Now, today, as you know, I don't know whether
you
got the report yet, but we had a bag snatching in the corner here. It's a black woman was knocked down against the wall, and we tried to comfort her, but she left with some other men there. She was upset. The officers come down, and actually they went down the alley looking for the culprit, but once they start running in the alley, it's almost impossible to catch them. This is what's got to be done. We got to have a little bit more patrolling in the area consistently, day in, day out, during business hours, particularly from 9 to 5:30. To help the storekeepers as well as the people that are shopping in the area. That's important, Deputy.
It's time that the black people begin to seize power and run these pigs out of our community. We don't need them in here. They're not helping our babies. The kid, Alfonso Johnson, his mother called the police, and they wouldn't even respond when her baby was in the elevator. They aren't doing any humane, anything for humanity. They're here to protect property.
We find that we're getting lack of police protection. We've discussed this some time ago with Lieutenant Cohen. He assured us of cooperation. Many days, you looked around, you couldn't find a police officer. You never even did. You find them tagging a couple of cars in front of Lairs and then walking up the street and disappearing. Now, we've had several stick-ups in our stores over there. We put calls in for the police. Crews that show up an hour and a half late. No excuse, just got the call. And then when they do come in and talk to you, you think you are the thief instead of somebody else.
There isn't a store between Williams and Dudley Station that hasn't been ripped off once, twice, and as many times as three times in 1 week. We've had a couple of murders. We've had one here at Tom McCann a couple of years ago. We had a shooting at the 5 and 10 with this gentleman. Here's the manager now. A manager that was almost killed, and a girl that was hit with the bullet. It was two people hurt in that particular instance. We've had a murder recently up the street here at Freeman's Furniture Store, as you gentlemen are well aware of, for no reason. As a matter of fact, the murderer only got about 20 or 30 cents or a couple of dollars or whatever it was. He lived in Providence, I believe, just the manager of a store. We have pickpockets. We have all kinds of things going on every single day in a week. We very, very rarely see a police officer. Now, this is what's going on, Commissioner, and I know you can do a lot to help us, and it's up to you, because if you don't help us, there'll be less stores in the area. It'll be another Blue Hill Avenue, like you've got now. And you've got nothing there, and you've almost got nothing here.
Well, look, let me tell you, I don't care if the commissioner gives me 200 more policemen, you're going to have crime in Roxbury. You're going to have crime in Dudley Terminal. Because what you're talking about, you're talking the same thing that we're seeing all over this country. Crime is increasing. Why? Because local governments, federal governments are treating symptoms and not problems. That's what they're doing. When you, wherever you got poverty, wherever you got people hungry, if you don't feed me, I'm going to steal something from you. That's what I'm going to do. So, I mean, why don't we face a reality? Why don't we face exactly what's happening in our society? We are here, yes. Our responsibility is policing. I want to assume my responsibility. I'm working 12 to 15 hours a day. I don't know a store I haven't been in yet. I want to have the answer for you. I want to have more policemen out there for you. But I think it's ironic for someone to sit here and say, I never see a policeman, when right now you know you see that little cushman I put out there for visibility. Move slow, a little better than a walking man, because he can hop off and on. At Guile Road and Ziegler and Washington Street, for the most part, I have been putting a traffic man at Ziegler and Washington Street. But that's not going to stop any crime. Because all I'm doing is treating symptoms. And I think that rather than get emotional to the extent whereby we are going to forget what we came here for, our purpose is to get with the association to find out what you can do and also what we can do to make the little community a little more viable than what it is today.
I have to sympathize with Deputy Chase because he has really hit, where it all lies. The only thing, of course, is not the answer for what you're concerned about today. But if anybody is going to sit in this room and say that Deputy Chase, for what he said, is full of crap, I would like to return it tenfold, sir, because if society doesn't recognize that it's society's fault for the position we're in the matter of crime, that the police do not create the crime. They have some effect if we properly direct our personnel to deter it. Don't think that just because we happen to be here and that we promise to do something for you that it's going to clear up crime. All that the police can do at the most is to displace crime. If we move a whole flock of officers into Dudley Terminal, which of course is your main concern right here, it's going to spring out two blocks down the street. And then we're going to move our personnel two blocks down the street, and it's going to pop out someplace else. Because of the problems in society, the need for crime is still there. That is what Deputy Chase was trying to say.
Just before this happened, I seen two guys dragging that same girl, Joan, down Blue Hill Avenue. And my daughter was with them, and I said, well, we... I
Who
said,
the guys?
I don't even know. She said, that, those are her uncles, and they said, they're going somewhere. They want her to show... They want her to go to this house where there's something like $800 at. And they were they're going to give us each a dollar. I said, you bring your behind right here, right now.
You should have called us on that so that we could... put the car on the surveillance and we could have followed them to see what the situation
but, you know,
was.
You know, see, you don't think of those things
see,
at that time.
Because this is strictly a police matter.
This was before this stuff happened.
Yeah.
You know.
Okay, listen, if you got any more information on, let us know.
Yeah.
In the meantime, we're going to do a further investigation on this anyway.
Yeah.
Okay?
What did you think of the mother?
She's covering up for the daughter.
Sure.
No two ways about it. And the girl didn't do it alone, so...
No. My only question is, what I really... I'm going to tell you, this is the way I look at it. I think the child is going in, checking out houses, right?
Right.
And she go back and tell the mother and the boyfriend what's happening. Because you look at that woman, I'm sure you're from Roxbury, right? All you got to do is look at folks. You know who's hustling from who's not hustling,
yes, sir.
Okay?
And being in this business 13 years, too.
You know what I mean? And,
anyway.
Okay.
We'll get in touch with you anyway. Yeah.
Thanks for watching.
All right.
Well, I've been on the force 21 years. And the average black policeman at that time knew that he was either going to be in 4, 9, or 10. Those were more or less the only divisions that they used to put the black policemen in. And in them days, we never was even able to get into a car. We was all footmen. You know you wasn't going to be in the car. And it took me about maybe 6 or 7 years to even get in the car for lunch, to relieve the other regular carmen for lunch. And that was a big thing in the department. But today, it's changed quite a bit. I think that they found out that you couldn't get to understand one another by segregating us.
Celester?
Yeah.
Moore?
Yes, sir.
Nine.
Police Station 3 covers Mattapan and parts of Dorchester, an urban area that is 85% black. Of the 160 police officers in Station 3, only 6 are black, a proportion that reflects the Boston Police Department as a whole. Patrolman Billy Celester is 31 years old, married and has 3 children. He has lived in the Roxbury-Dorchester area all his life. He joined the police force in 1968. A year and a half ago, he and his white partner, Jimmy Moore, asked to work together as a steady team. Like most black officers, Billy Celester feels that he would have a much better relationship with the community if more blacks were on the force. I don't see my role as protecting the establishment or the system, Billy says. I see my role as protecting home, where I live, where my kids grow up. I'm a member of the black community. I just happen to be a police officer.
Call it number one thing. You are a good little ambassador. Go up there. If you act in a polite, respectful manner, assuredly the public is going to respond in the same way. That's it, Sergeant.
Gentlemen, Charlie Gattamini has got his notary public stamp if you want it for your insurance. Right face, forward march.
That's why you come in here.
TPF, Tactical Patrol Force, the police department's elite corps of specially trained officers, best known for its riot control and anti-crime units. Bob Armistead and Arthur Morgan have been a team at TPF for the past 5.5 years. When they're not working as plainclothesmen in the anti-crime unit, they're canine specialists, officers who patrol with trained attack dogs.
About 2 days, and I said we'll go over there. Yeah, but when are we going to do it?
Oh, I don't know.
You got the complaint on the gun?
Why not?
Which one was continued?
Armistead and Morgan have been assigned to Roxbury and Dorchester for a long time. They like working in the black community where they live.
Okay, we'll talk.
Their friends jokingly call them super cops. The department sees them as a highly competent team because of an impressive record of arrests.
It's like an incognito thing, you know, where most of the kids in the street don't even know you, you know? Because we're just starting this, too. This thing just started, you know? for us. And the captain was good to give us a car and we ride around in plain clothes. I think it's going to help out a lot because you can spot more in a plain clothes car than you can in a marked car. Because you can see a marked car because it's all white and blue and you can see it a mile away. You know what I mean? This way we can observe and also have stakeouts as far as that's concerned. You know? And they won't even know it. They won't even know we're watching them.
All right, 2-3 is clear.
Like yesterday, we observed some kids on Von Park Street right over here. Two kids following a woman and talking and deciding whether or not to steal the handbag or not. But it just so turned out that the woman made a right turn off of Park Street into a crowded area. And they decided not to do it. But if the woman had walked straight ahead, we believe that they would have grabbed their bag. But we were right on them. We could have been right on them. Didn't pay no attention to us whatsoever. Just thought it was an ordinary car, you know?
This is like anything else. If you got a job that you like, when you get up in the morning, you go out, you do the job, you do it in a good frame of mind. They want to work with juveniles, and this is their life, I think they should do it. Bob and myself, we'd rather be out in a canine car, riding around looking for handbaggers or bank robbers or whatever may come our way. This is our thing. And I believe that if a man is good at what he's doing, you should let him do it.
And Digest and Jerry. And what's the phone number?
436-5427.
They've been grabbing pocketbooks in here, you know, that's just why we'd
rather lose the $80 than get hit in the head with a boulder.
They didn't hit you or anything, huh?
Yeah,
I said you don't want to go hospital.
I'd rather lose the $80 than get banged on the head with a boulder.
To me, man, a cat that rips you off is no better than a common criminal, man, and he has to go. Look, man, look. A man and woman get married and work hard every day. Every day. Finally, they save up enough money for a down payment on a stereo set or a component set. So a component set might cost $700. Now they have to work 3 years to pay for that component set. And here comes a man that calls himself your black brother, breaking into your house and stealing your component set. Right? To me, that man is just as bad as anybody that's even oppressing us, because he's helping oppress us too. If he's a junkie, I say try to help him, but put him where he can't hurt anybody until you do help him. That's how I feel about it.
All right, these are on a Mustang now. We'll be off at Martin and Willowood.
Follow the wagon.
Martin and Willowood.
Yes, sir. Would you have the wagon meet us here?
Okay.
Belongs on a Plymouth, Billy. Stolen December 29th of 73.
All right.
Stolen plate. Want to get out of the car? Shut it off.
Oh, man. It might be.
Come on. Shut it off. Yeah, put your hands on the car.
Yeah.
Big low after the car.
Wow.
Okay, why don't we skip the back? You call for a tow truck?
I call for a tow
truck. Can I get my tow truck?
We'll bring him up for
it. All right, I'm not going to run away.
I know you're not going to run away.
Why, man? Don't pull away from me, man. Just walk. That's all. Be nice.
Okay.
It hurts me more to see a black kid go wrong than it would a white kid go wrong. You know? Because here we are trying and struggling for 300 years and all that stuff, you know, trying to, you know, get the kids educated and all that sort of thing. And here they are out here ripping off their own people. See what I mean? They're ripping off their own, you know? And it really burns me up to see that. You know, I wouldn't want to see them rip off anybody, you know? But we have less here
than the white person does out there, say in West Roxbury or someplace out there. And yet they rip off their own right here. And these people work hard for this money. They work hard. And the little few luxuries that they do have somebody break into their home and they come home after 4 or 5 o'clock and find the whole home ripped off. You know, that really hurts. You know, because they don't know where the next one's coming. They don't know if they can replace the television and so forth.
We're all your friends, huh?
Yeah.
All right. I advise you to stay on the street because they had somebody breaking into that place just 2 minutes ago. That's what they said. I don't know. Maybe somebody saw you guys hanging up there, you know, and they figured that you were...
Yeah, I was knocking on the first floor to get into the room to ring the bell.
All right. Okay, then. Well, stay off the porch, all right? Because you don't want... Yeah, until your friend comes in, all right?
Yeah.
Because, you know, you'll be hanging in there and then some cop come here and blah, mistake you for, you know, somebody breaking in there, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, fellas.
I have to go back to how I got into this police community relations is that, see, I was in the, well, I walked the beat out in District 10, which is Old Roxbury Crossing, for 9 years. And then we had a plague of gaming. You know, the numbers, and they didn't have a black policeman in the gaming unit, and they just couldn't knock off them joints in the black community, because as soon as they saw a white face, they closed down. So I got a call to meet me at Back Bay Station and talk to Deputy Slattery, and he asked me, he said, I heard that you're a good policeman, and I would like to use you to knock off some joints. And he said, I'm not going to promise you anything. But at that time, I was making about $5,900 a year, and that was a lot of money in them days. And I told him, I said, well, look, I'm a policeman. So anyhow, I knocked off quite a few of the black gaming in a number of places in our community. And I was, you know, called the real Uncle Tom at that time, because I kicked in quite a few doors. But I wasn't taking anything from them bookies, and I had 3 children that I had to support.
Surrounding James Wilds and Walter Willoughby were just a magnification of day-to-day events that happen in black and third world communities throughout this country. In other parts of the country, in Detroit, Atlanta, New York, Los Angeles, people are starting to struggle against this repression. People are organizing.
Within a period of 2 months last summer, 2 black men died in separate incidents involving the police. Walter Roby, in a scuffle with 2 officers who were attempting to arrest him, was shot by accident in the abdomen and died shortly after in his cell. James Wiles, a Roxbury merchant, was mistaken for an escaped inmate of Norfolk Prison and shot by police when he ran from a stolen car.
Non-negotiable demand. We call for the immediate suspension without pay of Patrick Connolly and Peter Jerome, the officers responsible for the murder of James Wild Jr.
So directed at the police department in general, the rally held in front of Roxbury's police station 2 brought up the question again. Where do the black officers stand? And would the shooting have happened at all if the officers were black?
Police are arm of the state power. I mean, the police are a necessary arm, you know, of the class that exploits all of us. And black policemen are perpetuating that, you know, by the very fact that they are police. But like, you know, like every day, you know, the thing is becoming clear. Like, repression is heightening. In Atlanta, it was a black policeman that shot that young brother, you know, 15-year-old brother. It was a black policeman. It wasn't a white policeman.
What black police must do, and I think increasingly every day finding themselves faced with that, even if they're not conscious of this fact, is that they're going to have to really ask themselves seriously, you know, where is their interest? Is it with the continuous racist, you know, police brutality of the white police because they got blue uniform like the white police, or is it with the black community whom they're supposed to be here, you know, protecting?
Well, it's a little harder being a black police officer, because people in the black community have never had police, black police leadership, were in on the decision-making roles where their police, the type and the kind of police services that they receive in their community. And say, in my case, being sensitive to the needs of the people of a community like this, I find myself giving more, putting in more hours, and trying to satisfy as much as possible a total community. Now, this is very, very difficult because no one man can set himself up as a panacea, you know, for a community. But I do feel that when it's all done, as a black police officer, I would like to see the people of my community say that it was a job well done.
You can't satisfy everyone. Police officers learn that the first day on the job. But for black officers, it's difficult to shrug that off as simply a fact of any cop's life. The Massachusetts Association of Afro-American Policemen is one way for black cops to prove that they identify with community goals. It's also an indication of their awareness of their political power as a group. But in a department where blacks number under 3%, their power is limited. The association knows it will continue to fall short of community expectations until more blacks are on the force. As a result, many of their members are involved in recruitment. The group is also a social outlet for black officers. When you can't satisfy everyone on the outside, you get your friends where you can. On the inside.
Now, where he got into a car?
Yeah.
Yeah, what kind of a car? Blue Chevy? Did you get the plate number?
Uh-uh.
Is it an old car?
What year? Was it a late model? New one?
No, it wasn't new.
Was it banged up or anything like that?
It was kind of old, yeah.
Where's our Chevy?
Who?
Our Chevy's a banged up one. Show me.
Over there. Over there.
How about that one there? What does it look like compared to that Chevy over there? See it over there on the street?
Yeah, that new one. It was like that, yeah.
What is your name, sir?
When you become a policeman, most of your friends are policemen.
Because everybody, you know, most of the people, they just shun away from you for some reason or other. I think a lot of them are doing unscrupulous things. As far as I'm concerned, I don't even want to have nothing to do with them, I tell you. I don't know. Especially, I mean, when you're working in the area and you bust people in the same area where you live, hey, that's kind of tough, you know? And you're bound to bump into people that you have arrested, or their fathers, or their mothers, and then you gotta start talking all that talk again. I've had that happen to me too, you know?
I think there are so many negative things associated with being a police officer, period, to the black community, that whether you're a black police officer or a white police officer, you're looked at the same. I think it's just this tremendous task to ask one person to take the burden of the oppression and to try to change it. Maintaining that integrity in a relationship to the black community. I think it's possible and it's done, but for most of us it's done with a cost. And the cost is divorce. And the cost is a lot of loneliness. And the cost is isolation. Those are pretty high prices to pay.
Walk
down the damn
street, too. Right there. Same one.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah,
same one.
Yeah,
yeah. What?
Yeah.
I didn't steal that car.
No, I know. You have no business in the car, sir. Is it your car?
Man, you had to break my
arm. I'm not breaking your arm. I'm just holding you. Is that your car?
No.
Well, what are you doing in it?
I was just riding.
Do you have a driver's license?
No, I don't got no driver's license.
Well, you have no business in it, do you?
No.
You're under arrest.
For what?
Within a stolen car.
Hey, come on. Don't have to hold my arm like that.
A little boy, little boy, little boy. Come on, little boy.
Back there.
Rascal, ain't you?
You all set now?
You can let go of my arm, man.
Wait a minute, just be cool.
You have to put my arm way up there.
Girl, go away.
No! You look at my brother! Bitch, you have me dead!
Foster,
you have me dead! Bitch, you have me dead! What's that?
Oh!
But don't worry, we'll get you out of here. You look at my brother! You look at my brother!
Hit him, sister.
You got
hit him, sister. Hit him, sister. Hit him, sister.
Get him, sister.
Get
him,
sister.
Get
him,
sister.
Get him, sister.
Get him, sister. Get him, sister. Get him, sister. Get him, sister. Get him, sister.
Get away!
No, he's gonna shoot you! He's gonna shoot you!
He won't shoot you!
Let
go of my leg! Let go of my leg!
Let go of
my leg! Help him!
Wait a minute! Get him! 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 Get him!
Hey, get away from me or I'll put a bullet in you. Get away. You pull that stick on me again, I'll put the bullet right in your head. Now go away. This man is under arrest with the Boston Police Department. Now get out of here.
Yeah,
I warn you.
Hand, man. Let go of my
the last warning.
Don't shoot him.
The last warning.
Junior. Get him.
Junior,
trying to arrest a prisoner for me, and that's a felony. It's against the law. It's against the law.
Stab his ass.
Stab
his ass. Stab his ass.
Get him!
Hit him, Mark!
No, Junior!
Hit him, sister!
No! Hit him, sister!
Get out of here!
Stop! Stop, Mother!
Hit him!
Hit him! Bust the window!
Sister!
Hit him!
You stab him with that screwdriver, boy, and you're gone.
Hit him,
I warn you now.
Tell
me to get out of here. That's right. Tell me you're not there. Come on, Al. Call him again, for Christ's sake. You don't have to kill nobody. You get out of here, you little devil. You get out of here. Mind your business, little girl.
Sister, get the one in the car. Open the door and knock him out. Shit out of him.
Watch this side. Lock the window.
Lock the window.
Ah!
Sister!
You're true. Let me know what the situation is.
He was up with me, they would kill you.
371, would anybody know what's going on with him? I'm going to break the zone. Stay right where you are, sir. Stay right where you are. Here they come. Yeah, come the window.
What is this, on the news?
Yeah.
My name's Ulysses Freeman, Jr.
You're so smart now, huh?
I'm running for state representative.
Yeah, so am I.
Let go of my phone.
What's the best of the news?
Yup. That's on TV.
Shut up.
Hey,
Detectives!
A routine incident with a stolen car ends up in violent confrontation. Who is responsible? Are the police to blame for a resentment so damaging that children will be goaded by adults to act on adult frustrations? If someone had been hurt, would that have proven to the crowd that their feelings about cops are justified? Would it have been different had white cops been there? Is it even a question of black and white? You walk away from an incident like this with a lot of uncertainties. The questions that brought you there suddenly lost a much bigger reality.
You look out there, run you over.
Come on. Don't be pushing out a girl. Get out of here.
Hit me!
Okay, can you give the information on the right to remain silent? Anything you say could be used against you in court? You have the right to talk to the lawyer for advice before we ask you any questions, and to have him with you during questioning. You cannot afford a lawyer, one will be appointed for you before you any questioning if you wish. If you decide to answer questions now without a lawyer present, you will still have the right to stop answering at any time until you talk to a lawyer. Okay?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I've read to you?
Yeah.
Are you willing to talk to me about the case?
Yeah.
Position for grievance is to
read that again.
Please help.
Position for grievance is to
Okay.
Well, me and Jimmy have worked together. There's no such thing as white and black in our car. I mean, we're aware of it. We're aware that I'm black and he's white, but I mean, it's no big factor.
Yeah, you know, you bounce around, you're in and out with the different cars, and then all of a sudden you get with a guy, Billy and I started riding together, we're in the same squad, so we're hit together pretty much. And, you know, we can get along, we think pretty much the same, with the same ideas on a lot of things, and we can work good together.
You can't work every day with a guy you can't click with, you know? You gotta be able to click, you know?
I'm getting the description from him now. On the handbag.
Ernest, it's George here. You're gonna find out that any policeman that's on the job is another brother. And just like in your own family, you're gonna protect your own brother. Black and white. It's been like that as long as I've known. As long as I've been on the police department, everybody works together. You know, it's something that there's very few police officers in this world. And you have to back up your own. So it is a brotherhood.
Lawrence. I know I got that Lawrence down here. Did we take that address down before out there?
We had Lawrence down, but I don't think we had the street.
What score? All right. You're always in a rush. Always been in a rush.
484?
Yeah.
That's out of 500, right?
Yeah.
Right on. Right on. Right on.
Yeah.
Wild bunch of animals running around here, and crime is running rampant, and nobody cares. And it's not that way at all. A lot of people care, but a lot of people just do not identify with the police department. And this is something that we have to remedy. I have guys call me up, tell me who's dealing, who's not dealing. I don't necessarily go out and make the arrest myself, but I turn it over to the proper people that will make the arrest. But that is through all information gained from people I know in this community. The community's just not going to come to the black police officer just because he's black. The black police officer is going to have to prove to the community that he does care about his community and that he's willing to get out there and do something about his community. It's going to take mutual trust, and that's what we're trying to do now, build that trust within our community.
I'd like to thank the Black Philanthropies for this award. It's not too often that a policeman gets an award around here, but I'm thankful to the community. You know, I went on the police department in 1968. Since the time I've been on the police department, I've actively sought to get more blacks appointed to the police department. But we have a problem in this community. The problem is there's a lot of organizations and a lot of people that speak against blacks being on the police department. I talked to a lot of young men that would like to become police officers. And the reason why they don't is because they're afraid of what their friends will say or what the community will think of them. We have to stop a lot of organizations from telling kids that don't become police officers because you'll be working for the establishment. Or don't become police officers because it's going to be the white man telling you what to do. The white man's going to always tell us what to do until we put blacks in higher places in the police department. And we're not going to put blacks in higher places in the police department until we get blacks on the police department. So I just hope that a lot of people here and a lot of organizations, every time they have a chance to encourage a young man to become a police officer, they encourage him. Thank you.
Then the Puerto Rican guy comes up to me, and he was telling me what happened, right? And then we were standing there talking. He walked away down to the car, and he came back up, and he was talking to his officer here, right? And then his girl came up, or his wife, girl, whoever she was, she came up, right? And then she stands up there. Everything he says, right, the guy would translate it. Right? All of a sudden, if the girl can speak English, all of a sudden she couldn't speak English.
Well, this is what I'm telling you, right? Is the girl told...
Well, then wait a minute. Now then you're telling me that the girl, you know, like...
So you're saying you don't believe what I'm telling you, right? That's what you're saying, right?
What I'm saying...
Isn't that what you're telling me?
Let's put like this here. There's a failure to communicate somewhere, right? And what I want to know, where is the failure?
They want me to find out what happened to him, right? You know, what the charge was. That's what I said. I come down here, right? Because I was driving an ice cream truck and they came and got me, right?
I'll tell you.
I just come down here and find out what happened, right?
If you think...
And so, we filed the charge, you know?
No, seriously, it's not really that.
Somebody
think what?
If you think I'm trying to frame him, man, there ain't no sense in me even talking, man.
No, it's not that.
No, you guys...
I just want to make sure that you understand, right? That what happened
no
tonight.
Sense crying in here.
There's about three stories, right? Tonight.
Yeah, but we don't have anything to do with this story.
While you were standing there, this is what I'm talking about. Why were you telling me what was going on?
A complaint was made to us. We made an arrest on the complaint. That's the end of it. Now the whole thing straightens out in Dorchester Court. We haven't got any more to do with it. Those beads are lovely.
Crying babies on a doorstep. Help us out to be. Lady of the evening. Let your mind free. Grown up and a ghetto. Never seen a tree. If you don't.